Welcome to SJ's classes. Today we will discuss Kadamaneta Ramakrishnan's poem Shanta. Before we move into the poem, let's have a very brief introduction to the poet. M.R. Ramakrishna Panikkar, popularly known as Kadamaneta Ramakrishnan or Kadamaneta, was an Indian poet. He was born in 1935 in the Kadamaneta province of the Pathanamthitta district in Kerala. He completed schooling at his home village of Kadamaneta and at the nearby town of Pathanamthitta. He was employed with the Postal Audits and Accounts Department in 1959. He worked in Thiruvananthapuram from 1967 till his retirement as an accounts officer in 1992. He was elected to the Kerala Legislative Assembly in 1996 from the Aranmula constituency in Pathanamthitta district. He has also served as the president of the Kerala State Library Council and the Progressive Writers Association of Kerala. A profound influence in contemporary Malayalam literature, Kadamaneta had played a vital role in reviving interest in poetry by holding thousands of recital sessions in the form of cholkaichas in every nook and corner of Kerala in the 1970s and 80s. His childhood experiences, especially the Padayani songs, imparted strong influence in his literary work. Now, for those of you who have no idea about what Padayani is and Padayani songs are, Padayani is a folk performance tradition practiced in some parts of southern Kerala. Padayani songs invoke the Bhagavati, the mother goddess, in her primordial form. Padayani columns who dance before the Bhagavati to the intoxicating rhythms of the singers seek to draw power from the goddess and exorcise social evils. Kadamaneta didn't write much. The poems he wrote in an intensely creative phase of two decades don't even count up to 100. However, among these are some of the most powerful utterances in modern Malayalam poetry. It was his encounter with M. Govindan, an influential thinker and mentor to many modernist writers, in the 1960s that made Kadamaneta a poet. He was working as a clerk at the Audits and Accounts office in Madras when he met Govindan at a small literary gathering. His sharp comments drew Govindan's attention. Govindan sought him out later and convinced him that he could write poetry. The first poems were published in Sameeksha, an influential magazine edited by Govindan. Kadamaneta's first poem was titled Nyan and was published in 1965. His first book was published by Kerala Kavitha Granthavari in 1976. There are more than 75 books to his credit. His works have been widely appreciated for its force, energy and folk touch, and gave a mass appeal and popularity, making poetry enjoyable even to common man. Some of his important works are Kurathi, Kadinyul Pottan, Velli Velicham, Kaattalan, Suryashila, Shanda, Kuppayilondoru Manikyam. He translated Octavio Paz's Sunstone and Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Gotho into Malayalam. Some of his important collections of poems are Kavitha, that came out in 1976, Kadamaneta Kavithakal, that came out in 1983, and Mazha Peyunu Mandalam Kottunu, that came out in 1992. He was awarded the Kerala Sahitya Academy Award in 1982. He is also a recipient of the coveted Ashan Prize. This great poet died on 31st March 2008. Now let's move into the poem. I would also like to give you a short introduction to the poem. The poem was originally published in 1976 and later included in Kadamanitta's 1983 collection titled Kadamanittayude Kavithakal. One among the finest poems ever written in Malayalam, Shanta was a poem that he wrote under the backdrop of Indian Emergency of 1975. As you know, the Indian Emergency of 1975 refers to a 21-month period from 1975 to 1977 when Prime Minister Indira Gandhi had a state of emergency declared across the country. The poem is the soliloquy of a man, who is probably the poet himself, returning to his village home where Shanta, his wife, is waiting. But the realities of home are benumbing. In a time of doom, Shanta is the solace, the comfort. It is the woman waiting at the hearth, like the mother goddess, who he hopes will rescue him from the abyss of history. Shanta becomes representative of every woman, and she has to be invoked to rescue the home, the village, and the world. Now let us read the poem. Let's read the first stanza. Come, Shanta, come after your bath, change your wet dripping clothes, comb your dark tresses, gently moving your bangle-laden arms. Line your eyes and the arching eyebrows. With a studied abandon, mark the anjanam on your forehead. Come, light up the air with your smile, and sit down here beside me with all your grace. Like a hymn sung in praise of the evening goddess, and fill up this emptiness with a few dulcet words. So the very first lines introduces us to the two characters who appear in this poem. The speaker, who is probably the poet, and the lady named Shanta. So the speaker tells Shanta, come after your bath. Please do change your clothes as it is still soaked in water. And also comb your dark hair. Tresses actually means a hairdo formed by braiding the hair. But in this context, tresses means hair. So come after changing your wet clothes and also comb your hair. And please do it gently because you have bangles in your arms. You might hurt yourself. You might create a lot of noise because it is night. It is midnight. So you might create a lot of noise. So when you comb your dark tresses, be gentle. Gently do it. And also line your eyes and the arching eyebrows. Eyebrows that resemble an arch. With a studied abandon, mark the anjanam on your forehead. So with a studied abandon, you have to be very careful when you mark the anjanam on your forehead. While you mark a tilak, you have to leave certain areas and you have to focus on particular area. So do it with a studied abandon. Come, light up the air with your smile. So the air, the environment, the context is actually gloomy one. It's dark, it's midnight, and therefore the speaker asks Shanta to lit up the place, to light up the place with her smile. And sit down here beside me with all your grace, with all your elegance and beauty. Like a hymn sung in praise of the evening goddess, and fill up this emptiness with a few dulcet words. So fill up this emptiness with something pleasant, something which is extremely pleasing. And these are the requests that the poet, the speaker, makes to Shanta in the very first stanza. Now let's read the second stanza. Let your eyes shine like camphor lamps. Let your words be redolent of lovely musk. Caress my chest with your soft, nimble fingers and awaken me deep inside. No evenings for us, I know, only midnights. And these are magical moments, rested, unexpected. Let us therefore fill them with meaning. I see your eyelids grow heavy after a hard day's work at the hearth, huffing and puffing on your haunches in the kitchen. Smoke-dulled eyes brim with scalding tears. Unkempt hair speckled with ash, the smudge of soot on your face, the 3-inch long scar on your sweating back, the tear on your black blouse below the splotchy armpit. I see it all. Let your eyes shine like camphor lamps. Camphor, as you know, is referred to as karpuram in Malayalam. It's the resin that is obtained from camphor tree. So let your eyes shine like camphor lamps. Let your words be redolent of lovely musk. Let your words be filled with the smell of musk. You refer to that in Malayalam as kasturi. Kasturi mande kasturi. Yes, which is a glandular secretion from the male musk deer, and it has a very pleasant smell. So let your words be filled with such lovely musk. Caress my chest. He asks her to touch or strike lightly his chest. And he asks her to do this with her soft, nimble fingers. Nimble means quick. And awaken me deep inside. So touch me and awaken me. Awaken my heart, my mind and my soul. The poet says, the speaker says, no evenings for us, I know, only midnights. Probably that is the time when the speaker returns home. And these are magical moments. Perhaps I return home very late. We have only midnights for us, but these are magical moments. Rested unexpected. We have got it unexpectedly. We had to obtain it forcibly. That is the meaning of the word rested. Let us therefore fill them with meaning. So let's not idly spend it away. Let's not make it meaningless. Let's fill them with meaning. I see your eyelids grow heavy after a hard day's work at the hearth. My hearth is the place of cooking. So the poet sees that, the speaker sees that her eyelids have grown heavy. She has become very tired after a day's work in the kitchen. Huffing and puffing on your haunches in the kitchen. So she is using these utensils to cook the food. She is forcibly blowing, she is puffing, she is exhaling out forcibly so that she can cook food. Smoke dulled eyes brim with scalding tears. So her eyes is probably burning with, this is a kind of imagery that the poet draws. Her eyes is burning with the hot tears because of the intense heat from the hearth. Unkempt hair speckled with ash. Unkempt means not in a proper manner, not neatly combed. So her unkempt hair is speckled with ash. Speckled means in dotted manner, having a pattern of dots in a dotted manner. So what is there on her hair in a dotted manner? Ash. Because she had been in the kitchen for a long while. The smudge of soot on your face. Smudge means a blemish, a dirt mark. And from where that dirt mark has come? From the kitchen, from the place, from the hearth. And it has come out of the soot, what remains after the fire. The 3-inch long scar on your sweating back. The tear on your black blouse below the splotchy armpit. I see it all. The 3-inch long scar, probably she had a wound. As of now, we don't know about the wound, or probably it can even mean the tear that is on her blouse. But in addition to this, he also talks about the tear on your black blouse below the splotchy armpit. Splotchy means irregularly shaped. So what she is wearing is something which is very irregular, which does not fit her at all. But still, since she doesn't have another option, she is wearing it. And the poet says, I see it all. But Shanda, let us forget all that and snatch a few moments for ourselves. Let us sit down in this little courtyard and enjoy as one the beauties of this vast sky. The spectacle of a 1,000 Kantari flowers blooming on the high mountain ranges which no man or beast can scale. Of the deer sporting about in the sky. And seeing all this, let's sing. 1,000 Kantaris bloom on the mountain ranges that no man scales, on the mountain ranges that no beast climbs. Here is a deer with a crescent on the antlers. A deer with crescent on the antlers. leapt up from the sky, leapt up from the sky. The present deer, the crescent deer, make a ring around my yard, make a ring around my Shanta. So the poet sees everything that is not so commendable about Shanta, the scar on her back, her torn blouse. But the poet says, let us forget all that and snatch a few moments for ourselves. Let's forget all the shortcomings. Let's forget all that is bad in our lives for a moment and let us snatch a few moments for ourselves. Let us sit down in this little courtyard and enjoy as one mind and body the beauties of this vast sky. And he also describes a few sights that he sees. The spectacle of 1,000 Kantari flowers, the Kantari chili, the flower of the plant, how the entire field when Kantari blooms is lit up in a magnificent manner, how the Kantari chili looks like a flower. So all sorts of imagery associated with the Kantari plant can be taken up over here. The spectacle of 1,000 Kantari flowers blooming on the high mountain ranges which no man or beast can scale. So these are there high up in the mountain ranges, and this has not been measured, or nobody, no man, no beast has ever reached the highest point of this mountain ranges. And he also describes the deer sporting about in the sky, the deer moving about in the sky. Probably he is talking about the clouds in the shape of deers. And seeing all this, let's sing. So he says, let's sing together this song. And the song is, 1,000 Kantaris bloom on the mountain ranges that no man scales. So these lines resemble the lines which were actually spoken by the speaker a bit earlier. 1,000 Kantaris bloom on the mountain ranges that no man scales, on the mountain ranges that no beast climbs. Here is a deer with a crescent on the antlers. So the speaker imagines a cloud to have the shape of a deer, and he says, here is a deer with a crescent on the antlers. Crescent here refers to the crescent moon, the curved shaped moon. Here is a deer with a crescent on the antlers. Antlers refers to the deer's horns. A deer with crescent on the antlers leapt up from the sky, leapt up from the sky. So he sees this deer leaping up from the sky, and he has this crescent moon on the antlers, on the horns of the deer. The present deer, the crescent deer, make a ring around my yard. So the speaker requests this deer, make a ring around my yard, probably a ring of protection, and also make this ring around my Shanta. So mark this ring around my yard, protect my home, and also protect my Shanta. So that is all for today. The remaining stanzas will be discussed in the next video lesson. Thank you so much for joining me. I'll see you in the next video lesson.